Well, good morning to everyone, dear guests, fellow mayors, C40 colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. After two wonderful days here in Johannesburg, I know you may be tired because of the long agenda, parties, but I'm sure you share the same enthusiasm that I feel now. In addition to a great meeting of the steering committee on Tuesday, yesterday we had the opportunity to attend three excellent plenary sessions where we heard from speakers such as Andrew Steer from the World Resources Institute and Cristiana Figueres from UNFCCC, with whom I'm pleased to say we are willing to build a great partnership, as well as many fellow mayors who presented their policies and proposals. Together with the four breakout sections, it was a very productive day with interesting reports and exciting proposals on various themes. Most important was the presentation of the update Climate Action in Megacities report, which confirmed the leadership of C40 cities and their unequivocal prominence in establishing pragmatic and innovative policies. So we have a great chance. Let's build upon this momentum. We have obviously so few opportunities to be together without the constraints of governing, and I'm really encourage each of you to make the most of this day. To remind you, we have delegations from over 40 C40 cities here. Just think about that. It's lots of knowledge and possibilities. 40 delegations from the world's mega cities are here today. So let me give you a taste of the knowledge sharing opportunities we will have today. After the presentation of the C40 Executive Director, Mark Watts, the next plenary will discuss how growth can be linked to prosperity and livability. After the coffee break, we'll have our first four breakout sections on risk assessment, ports, measurement and reporting, and sustainable infrastructure finance. After lunch, another round of breakout sessions will cover energy efficiency, delta cities, transport, and intelligent infrastructure, with a special session on Johannesburg climate change projects. In the summit's final plenary, we'll have the illustrious presence of Juan Claus, Executive Director of UN Habitat and former mayor of the incredible, fantastic city of Barcelona, who has kindly accepted the invitation to join Mayor Tal and I to debate on setting targets for urban sustainability. This meeting is what we make it. Talk to each other, learn from each other, share with each other, and talk to me. Let me know what else C40 can do for you. And to start our activities today, I'm delighted to welcome to the stage Mark Watts, our Executive Director of C40. Mark was instrumental in the creation process of C40 back in 2005 with Mayor Livingston. In London, he also led the developments of London's groundbreaking climate change action plan and the associated program of projects to reduce London's carbon emissions by 60% by 2025. After having worked for 5 years in one of the leading engineering companies in the world, he accepted to return to C40 as our new executive director. We could not be in better hands, so Mark will now present C40's current application accomplishments and future goals for the next 3 years. So I wish you all have a great day. Enjoy this meeting, this gathering. Let's get things done here, and we will meet again in the final plenary. Thank you very much. Mark, please.
Thank you very much, Mayor Pires. And thank you to all of you for turning out this early in the morning. You're obviously the hardcore crowd, given the party last night. Well, I've got to say, it is a bit early, but I woke up with a real buzz this morning because I just thought yesterday was so fantastic. Right through the whole day, everywhere, there were cities getting together, working out new ideas for collaboration, new networks, new regional associations. I met at least 20 or 30 people that I really want to get in touch with straight after this summit to talk about new ideas that we can work on together. And I think we were educated as well. I certainly learned a couple of new words yesterday. From Mayor Bloomberg, Unilat, which I'm going to remember, and from Mayor Pyers, Polis Digitocracy, which I think everyone's going to have to remember because I think we're all going to be focusing on it over the next few years. But seriously, also, I think I felt, as someone who's been around the C40 since it started, just really got a sense of progress yesterday, particularly that discussion with Christiana Figueres, a real sense that not only is tangible progress being made towards tackling climate change in our member cities, but also we're now being listened to at the intergovernmental level. And the door is really open for us to get in there and put real pressure on and demonstrate what can be achieved in tackling climate change so that there is a positive outcome from the climate talks in Paris in 2015, which are so critical. So I'm really buzzing this morning. I hope you are too. I'm delighted to have the opportunity to present my first executive director report about the C40 this morning. And whilst, I say, mission statement on the screen there, slightly summarised, whilst what the C40 is completely about is you, the member cities, and what you're doing in your cities to tackle climate change, and we are very much a membership-led organisation, organised by cities, for cities to tackle climate change. What I'm hoping to do this morning is talk also a little bit about what we, the staff of C40, are doing on your behalf to deliver our mission at C40. Now, I'm hoping this clicker's going to work. Do I have to point it? It does. So, and I think I wanted to introduce our staff to you. That's not all of them on the screen because I couldn't get them all on. But I think I'm allowed to say this because I've only been in post for a few weeks. So I can say it without showing off, but we have a phenomenal team at the C40. No one who's working on the staff at C40 is doing it to get rich, or because certainly not because they want an easy life. They're all doing it because they're completely passionate about tackling climate change and completely passionate about the roles that cities have to play in doing that, and convinced that all of you, all the people here today, are the people who can lead the world in achieving, avoiding catastrophic climate change. And they have been working absolutely round the clock to make this summit a success and will continue doing so right through to the end of today. There are only 37 people on our staff, but sometimes it feels like there are 60 or more, given the amount of work that they get through. And in fact, I'd like them all just to stand up, please. All the staff are in here, just so you can see them. And let's give them a round of applause for the work they do on your behalf. Thank you. So I'm not going to bore you with sort of endless detail about our staff structure, etc., but I thought it might just be useful, because you all interact with different people, just to give you a bit of an idea of how we're organised. So we have four principal teams and a management team. A regions and cities team, which are the people who work with you, the cities, on a day-to-day basis to make sure that we understand what you want to get out of the C40 and to help you fulfil your membership requirements. Our regional and city directors. We have five regional directors in place at the moment, but I'm very pleased to say we'll soon have filled the full seven places. Our initiatives and networks team, which are the people who run all the fantastic networks that you're involved in, from green growth through to bus rapid transit. Our dynamic duo in the research team, Seth and Kerem, who produced that fantastic report, The Climate Change Action in Megacities, that we saw yesterday. And our communications team, which work very hard on your behalf to make sure that you get great coverage for the things that you're doing all around the world. And then, as I say, there's a small management team. We're pretty small at the moment. We're 37 people, but we're intending to grow quite rapidly. So we'll be advertising for around 20 new positions over the rest of the year, and I really hope that some of you may be able to persuade your mayors to do some comments, or will be able to tell us of good people that we can bring into the C40, because we really want to have people who've got experience of city government and what you're all doing. I also just wanted to quickly say a little bit about how we're organised. I know you, most of you know this, but just so it's completely clear that we really are a membership-led organisation. And that's recognised first in the C40 Steering Committee, which is made up of representatives of mayors from each of our regions and chaired by Mayor Pyers. And the Steering Committee sets the overall strategy for the C40. It's previously been made up entirely of the mega cities, the really large cities within the C40, but recently the Steering Committee agreed to create a new place on the Steering Committee for one of the innovator cities, and then there's an election that will be happening towards the end of this month. The Steering Committee is supported by a board of directors, the president of which is Mayor Bloomberg, and the board is made up of a combination of representatives of cities from the Steering Committee, but also our three key funders, who I'll talk about a little bit more in a moment, along with the Clinton Foundation, who were one of the founders of this organisation. And I do want to just, without embarrassing them, say a quick word about our three principal and very generous funders, because we are in a fantastic position in C40 in being able to serve you, in that we, unlike most NGOs, we're fully funded to deliver our business plan for the next 3 years, around $10 million a year, which is only possible because of these three organisations, Bloomberg Philanthropies, Realdania, and the Children's Investment Fund Foundation. And the most important thing in this for all of you, I know that you as cities make a huge contribution in terms of your time and indeed money to working in C40 and with C40, but the fact that we have these three really generous donors means that we don't have to charge you a membership fee, which, given all the things that we do, it would be quite considerable, and I know the difficulty of getting that through city administrations. So they make a fantastic difference to what we're able to do. And I do want to thank here my predecessor, Jay Carson, along with Rit Agarwala, for the work that they did in securing this funding and indeed delivering such a clear business plan that our team now has to deliver. I feel very lucky to inherit what Jay and Rit have created, although if they were on the stage now, they would remind me not to rest on my laurels, because whilst we are well funded to deliver what's already been planned, everything I'm hearing over the last 2 days is you want us to do a lot more and to expand, and therefore we'll need to raise more money to do more things. So this is what we look like, as you will be very familiar with. It will have three new dots on it, as we heard yesterday, three new member cities in Africa, but we hope over the next year or two there'll be many more dots on there as we expand in line with the strategy set out by the Steering Committee for the C40 to truly represent all of the world's megacities, which will mean, in particular, a lot more cities in the global south and East Asia and Africa in particular. So that's the sort of introduction about how we're organised. I want to now run through a little bit about what's been achieved over the last 2 or 3 years, but also where we're going in the future. Hopefully this summit is already providing you with quite a clear indication of that direction, but I'm going to give a little bit of the detail. Now, fundamentally, since day one, C40 has been about sharing knowledge, based on the principle that the best person for one city official or one mayor to talk to find out how to improve what they're doing in their city, is to talk to another city official or another mayor in a different place. And there are lots of ways that we implement that principle throughout the operation of the C40, but one of the foundations of that approach is our research and knowledge management program. I want to start by talking about perhaps one of the less visible aspects of that, but one which I know many of you are using, which is our new C40 Exchange intranet service, which is a very well used, there are over 500 users now, even though it's only emerging from its testing phase, an intranet service that allows you to talk to each other in privacy, to exchange documents, for the C40 staff to be bringing to your attention new developments, new ideas, innovations, and technologies in a completely secure platform. We also have been launching at this summit our new website, c40.org, which has a network space for those who are involved in the networks to engage in a dedicated research space, and increasingly it will have a case study library so that we're documenting all of the great things that each of you are doing so that you can just pull it off the virtual shelf to be able to copy and understand in each city. This is the only graph this morning, I promise you, but I'm a management consultant in recovery, and I can't resist putting a graph on the screen. But just to talk to you a little bit about how we use the data that we were talking so much about yesterday, those 1.7 million data points in the Climate Action in Megacities report. Because part of the use of that, of course, is to make the case to the rest of the world about why cities are important, to demonstrate that you're all taking increasing action around climate change. But there's another purpose from the C40 team's point of view. We use that to work out how we can devote our resources most efficiently to helping you. So we call it an opportunity score. We look at each of the different actions, interventions that you're delivering in your cities. We try and calculate what is the potential to scale them up, what's the potential for replicability in other cities, and then we look at that against the relevant mayoral powers in each of our cities. And that then gives us a very kind of rough score about which are the things that have the greatest opportunity to be introduced at scale and which cities we can bring together to try and achieve that. Of course, that is the most important thing. That data is a kind of background. The most important thing is what you tell us about what you want us to do and want us to focus on. But it gives us some really hard data by which to manage our program. The one I've put on the screen here shows that we should be focusing on congestion charging and road pricing, which is something very dear to my heart, having spent 3 years introducing such a scheme in London. I know for all of you that is not the right thing, but for some, it's an initiative that can be introduced. So I talked before about our initiatives team, which is where all of the people running our networks reside. You're familiar with the different issues that we cover within them. And I just want to say a little bit about some of the fantastic peer-to-peer exchange networks events that have occurred over the last year. Going through the pictures, the Sustainable Solid Waste Systems Network visited Rio to provide on-the-ground support to their efforts for the management of their landfill sites. In June, we were in Rotterdam hosting a meeting of the C40's original network, the Connecting Delta Cities Network, where we launched a new climate risk assessment. In November, we were in Stockholm working on the groundbreaking climate development program, 18 mixed-use developments at really large scale, delivering zero carbon neighbourhoods around the world. In October, I was very fortunate to be part of the Green Growth Network meeting in Copenhagen, which was really truly inspiring. Look at how we can measure the value of green economies. And later that month, we were in Jakarta for the first in-person meeting of the BRT network, and I am told, looking at what is the longest BRT in the world. And what's fantastic for us about these networks is that we can see that they're really working, because 80% of our cities are now participating in at least one network, and over half of you are participating in more than one network. And lastly, in terms of the services that we provide, but not least, we provide on-the-ground support to you through our regional and city directors, whom are the people you all know very well. And Mayor Pyers announced yesterday that we'll be launching a new city director program, a competitive program to allocate one new city director this year to seven cities, one in each region, who will be able to take leadership of a project or a program in your city based on need and ambition. And I very much look forward to all the applications rushing in to deliver those. But finally, one of the things I hadn't really appreciated till I started working at the C40 is what we can do to help raise your profile for all the great things you're doing through our communications facilities. We have some fantastic partnerships. You can see some of them on the screen. In addition to those, CNN and National Geographic. So we're pushing out the message of all the wonderful things that you're doing all the time. And indeed, this year, thanks to support from our partner Siemens, we launched the new City Climate Leadership Awards in order to reward success. And it was great to hear last night from some of the winners of those awards just what a difference that makes, that often you can't persuade your media to talk about the great things you're doing around climate change in your city, but when someone external comes in and says that you're a great success, then they are happy to start talking about it. So that's our core program at the moment. Looking ahead, you heard yesterday from Mayor Pyers, he very much wants us to focus around the issue of city diplomacy, how we can really make the C40's presence felt in the lead-up to Paris in 2015, and I'm hugely excited about that, as are all the staff, and you could see yesterday that we've really got an opportunity to move ahead on that. So that's all I want to say this morning in introduction, other than just to say that every day in this job so far has been a real joy. I think we've got really, really exciting times ahead of us. It's an extraordinary privilege to work with all of you. And I have to say, what a great leadership we have. Having worked for one great mayor in London, Mayor Livingston, to now have the opportunity to work for two extraordinary mayors in Mayor Pyers and Mayor Bloomberg, this organisation really is blessed, I think, with the best leadership in the world around cities and around climate change. And with leadership like that, the sky's the limit. I look forward to working with all of you over the coming years, and I hope we have a great day for the rest of the summit today. So now we turn to our first plenary session of the morning, Healthier, Wealthier Cities, and I'd like to introduce my predecessor, Jay Carson, now a member of the C40 board. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone. It's my pleasure to announce our first plenary session this morning. Thank you all for being here on a very early morning on our last day of the C40 Summit. So without further ado, I'd like to invite to the stage Mayor Guy Morin, Mayor Gregor Robertson of Vancouver, our host, Mayor Parks Tau, and Minister Manuel, Trevor Manuel. So we're going to actually take it a little easy on national governments today because we have a Minister of Parliament here with us. So we'll lay off of our friends in charge of our federal government. So, let's get right to it. Part of one of the things I want us to address today, and we've talked about this backstage, is this false dichotomy we still hear around the world. Where C40 is a political organization. All of us on this stage, except for me, are elected officials. And part of being an elected official is obviously making the case for what you want to do when you're elected. And there's a false dichotomy that I feel exists at the federal level, but certainly at the city level too, between I'm going to choose to do sustainability, make my city greener, or I'm going to choose economic development. And so I'd love to start out with some examples of how each of you have combated that at a city level and then at the ministerial level, Minister Manuel. Start with you, Mayor Morin.
Yes, Basel is known because of the Bank of International Settlements, Basel I, Basel II, Basel III, the regulatory framework of the banks. So we decided that the main problem of sustainability is the funding of the needs of infrastructures. And that's a very big issue for all of us. So we decided to try to bring together the owners of infrastructure projects with the banks, with the financier, to look out to create assets for the banks to invest in infrastructure. So we created this Global Infrastructure Basel, and it's a congress, a meeting of owners of infrastructure projects with financiers, with the World Bank, and so on.
And how's it going? I mean, I think many of us in the audience have been to Global Infrastructure Basel, but how does it work? I mean, do the financial institutions understand the needs of cities? I mean, I think sometimes, as a former deputy mayor, these conversations, you start them, but the financial institutions don't actually understand what we need or how to execute it.
You come and you have to present your project, and present the sustainability, the winnings of your project, and we try to create an asset for this project. So the finance institutes have an incentive to invest and to help you.
Mayor Robertson.
Yeah, it's good to be here. Good to see everyone out this morning. Vancouver's history is steeped in resource industries. Vancouver is the largest port on the west coast of North America, and we basically were created as a city to harvest the forests of Western Canada, to build mines. That was what built a lot of the infrastructure of the city originally. But over time, generations made actually very wise decisions about land use and the infrastructure of the city. They protected the watersheds, the mountains next to the city. They protected the agricultural land from development and concentrated the development in the urban core. So there have been really good decisions made over time that basically made Vancouver among the most livable cities in the world. Over the last few years, we're generally in the top 3 to 5. When I came into office, one of my key goals was to make Vancouver the greenest city in the world by 2020. And to basically build off of that platform, which, as I saw it, we already had a very strong base, the lowest carbon emissions in North America, in large part due to hydroelectric power that was developed in our province. We get lots of rain, and that means lots of green power. But we had that good base, and what has happened over the last couple decades is our economy has shifted to about 95% service industry with a heavy leaning into clean technology and creative industries. So we've attracted people from all over the world to focus on basically a low-carbon economy. We still have a resource base that's a strong part of that, but I saw the future of our city as being as maintaining a component of resources and doing as sustainable as possible job, managing those resources, exporting the resources, but that the core economy of the city would be about sustainability, would be about green, would be using our brain power. And so we've basically shaped the future of the city with an action plan to 2020 that puts us on that course to be the greenest and to support that high quality of life. What's emerging at the same time is a challenge with affordability, which I think we'll come back around to, because now we have lots of people wanting to live in Vancouver, and it's a limited land base and expensive.
It's a high-class problem, but it sounds like you're actually able to run on sustainability in Vancouver. When you're running for election, yep. You're actually able to say, this is one of my leading goals. I think not every mayor gets that, has that benefit in their city, but tell us more about how you're able to do that.
It was definitely central in my campaign, 2008. I was elected the first time and then reelected in 2011, three-year terms. It was, I think it's the goal of being the greenest and shaping our economy with that, I think was aspirational. It was focusing more on the positive of the combination of economy and environment than that would serve quality of life and ultimately create more jobs for the long term in the city for young people. So I think people, it resonated. Obviously, I kind of swept in a whole team to a supermajority of council in two successive elections. So there is that support. That gives us, I think, an opportunity, but I think it creates also an obligation. If we have that kind of political support and drive in Vancouver, we need to use it. We need to leverage that and be able to advance on all fronts and help share, help be part of C40 and help spread what we learn.
And I definitely want us to come back to this idea of sharing between mayors. Mayor Paez, our chair, will talk about bus rapid transit in the city of Rio. And he'll say to us, as he was saying backstage, that bus rapid transit, when you're selling it to the people of Rio, you don't talk about it as a greenhouse gas reduction scheme. You talk about it as a way to reduce traffic, get people to work faster. But when you're at a conference like this, you can count the tonnage that it's actually reducing. So, Mayor Tao, I think you're probably in a similar situation in terms of what you're running on when you're running for election. And I'd love if you could tell us more about the corridor of freedom that Johannesburg is doing that you're leading.
Okay, thank you very much and good morning. The city of Johannesburg decided that essentially for us to confront the critical problems that we have with regards to addressing the socioeconomic inequalities in our city, we would need to confront one of the most defining features of what we inherited as a democratic dispensation, which is a city designed around separation and racial segregation and essentially marginalizing the poor to the outskirts with black townships outside the core city and inadequate access to social, economic, and other infrastructure. We identified the corridors of freedom as a platform from which we can do a number of things. Firstly, the objective is to restitch the city of Johannesburg, to essentially stitch the different parts of the city through a transit-oriented development initiative that would enable us to increase densities in certain of the corridors, increase the densities fourfold, and in certain instances even fivefold. But it's not just about residential densities, it's about increasing the intensity of land uses so that you have greater and closer proximity to a range of amenities because of the reality that historically black townships had limited amenities. So as a means of enabling the city to function in a more sustainable way, we can ensure that we use less infrastructure for more people because we're able to then ensure that people have greater access and therefore a reduced requirement for transportation, public transport, private transport, because they have amenities and activities closer to them. So the corridors of freedom have become a defining feature of what we think a future city of Johannesburg should be. It should be a city that's premised on integration, on socioeconomic development, and on a comprehensive sustainable development agenda.
Is it, as you're acting as mayor, as you're running for mayor, and you've conceived of this idea of the corridors of freedom, and you're talking about it to the citizens of Johannesburg, how does that work? And then once you become mayor, is it a difficult process? Because I think one of the great things about C40 is we talk about actually how we get things done. So was this something you ran on and you were just able to do it right when you get into office, or what's the actual process to making that happen once you become mayor? Was it difficult? Was it something that people, you had a mandate to do it, and so it was fairly easy?
Well, not easy, not at all.
Nothing is.
I mean, our approach was to place emphasis on a comprehensive growth and development strategy for the city of Johannesburg, because we need to undertake a process of understanding the challenges and opportunities in our city, and on the basis of that, presenting to the people of Johannesburg and the institutions, business, commercial, academic, and other stakeholders in the city of Johannesburg, a set of analysis that say these are the problems, these are the issues, these are the opportunities, the basis on which we developed a growth and development strategy and agreed on Joburg 2040. So the corridors of freedom are a culmination of, or rather a product of the growth and development strategy, because it then said how do we restructure our city from a spatial point of view to address the key issues that we think need to be addressed. So if one were to go back, I would say there's a much broader strategy that is about Joburg 2040. The strategy looks at all the issues ranging from the economy, climate change, sustainable development, to food security, adequate transportation, addressing the quadruple burden of disease. So it's a more comprehensive strategy. Our approach is that in the first 10 years, we've got 10 priorities that we've identified. One of those is resource sustainability, in which theme climate change falls. And that is really what we're driving as the city of Joburg, a comprehensive strategic intervention to deal with the issues that we have to confront.
And did you, one more question, we'll move to Minister Manuel, but did you control all the, back to our climate action and megacities report, did you control all the levers of power that you needed to do to actually make the transit-oriented development work, or did you have to go and strong-arm other parts of the government to actually make it happen?
We certainly need government. A lot of the decisions are, to a large extent, dependent on the interface between ourselves and the two other spheres of government. And I'll make an example. When we procured the BRT buses, we had to make a decision about how we source funding for the BRT buses, the first and second phase that we implemented. we had to have agreements on a conversion of the subsidy schemes because there's a historic bus subsidy scheme that comes from government, and we needed access to that bus subsidy scheme. We also needed a mechanism to finance infrastructure and reinforce the city financing on infrastructure. So it's actually a partnership that has to work between us and government. And it doesn't mean that you don't, in certain instances, find that you don't agree on every single detail. And you need to work through the challenges and say, these are the policy objectives. So you find that when we started with the BRT, it was primarily to respond to an integrated transport plan of the city. This has now evolved into the backbone of our transit-oriented development corridors. So it's now playing a much more strategic role from a comprehensive socio-economic development point of view, because it's now a spatial redefining feature of the city of Johannesburg. So it's moved beyond mobility to be about city structure and morphology.
Thank you. Minister Manuel, you're a leading part of the Oxford-Martin Commission. The C20, C30, C40 concept. It's sort of in the DNA that it is a false dichotomy to choose between sustainability and economic growth. But can you tell us more about the genesis of that idea and where it's going? When we heard about it at C40, we were obviously very excited. I would love to hear more about where these plans will take us.
Briefly, the Oxford Martin Commission was convened in September 2012. 19 commissioners, chaired by Pascal and me, trying to understand what the major problems are confronting decision-making in the world. And there's so much stasis. If you look at the entire multilateral system, it's kind of bogged down in itself. And the big challenge for us was to try and think through the nature of the failure, to get beyond the diagnosis, and to put on the table a series of proposals. And so the report that was released in October last year, the commission is a funny thing because it's not a UN commission, it's not owned. And so the report, we hope, will be used very extensively. We're happy that there have been over 700,000 downloads. And clearly it's the kind of issue that presents to people like mayors in the C40 who can take the ideas forward. There are 15 key recommendations, but one of those, it's well-timed because of Paris 2015, is to recognize that, the UN system is bogged down. And we brought a lot of evidence to bear, and Pascal Lamy, having sat through the WTO round after round, was very well aware of this. The short route is the G20, but the G20 is also bogged down. So the proposal is to take 20 countries, and it might be the same G20 countries, systemically significant countries, 30 corporates, and they could be the biggest emitters, so that you've got some skin in the game, and the 40 key cities, and the C40 comes into that. And if we can construct this alliance and get a lot of movement between now and Paris next year, I think there's likely to be a lot of traction for ideas that will change movement in respect of climate change and a series of other issues. I think the key challenge is how to make cities more livable. We also, and I hope that the mayors would be interested in this, there are a series of proposals about fit cities. So it's not just the climate change stuff. In the context of livability, how do we get our cities fitter? How do we use city space and spatial development issues to respond to non-communicable diseases? WHO says 37 million people a year now die due to non-communicable diseases, the bulk of them in lower and middle-income countries. We need to look at the urban space and change that. Fundamentally important. And the other big proposal we're making is to think about young people and participation differently. Somehow, our generation, and I look a bit tad older than my brother Park Tao and them, but our generation has taken too much off the table. Underinvested in young people, there's a fundamental problem. It's manifest also in decision-making in the multilateral system. We need to rethink that, think about how young people are brought into decision-making, take ownership of issues, and drive change by opening government and participation differently. So these are three of the 15 proposals that I think ought to find a lot of resonance with the C40, because we need to drive a program of change differently. We can't merely sit back and say that the UN system isn't delivering what we need.
I think on that topic, and so we don't leave here too depressed this morning, we were talking some backstage about what is broken about that system, and you were talking about this concept of mini-lateralism. What's broken about the system that we in this room, that the mayor is sitting here, what part of it can we help influence and help fix? Because we had Christiana Figueres here yesterday. We had a great conversation with mayors. I think everyone at this table wants to figure out what part of that we can actually change. You're intimately involved in it. Can you tell us more about this idea of mini-lateralism and what cities and mayors can actually do to help fix the broken process? Maybe slightly off topic here, but I think we're probably interested in it.
Look, the fundamental problem was that, or the great opportunity at the end of World War II was an opportunity to construct multilateral organizations. World Bank, IMF, and interestingly, an international trade organization agreed to at Bretton Woods. The ITO was put on hold for 50 years because the US Senate couldn't approve it. And then the UN replacing the League of Nations. But if you look at the number of sovereign states who participated in that process, it's a small fraction of what we have now. But the structures, if you look at the UN, you look at the Security Council, the rules agreed to at that point, they've all been overtaken by time and circumstance. Nobody wants to give up anything. So if it's just about states and their representativity there, I think we're going to continue on pretty much the same track. If we convene cities, you close the gap between voice and decision, and I think you can bring into bear a layer of governance that's actually very focused. I'm impressed by the experiential and shared learning that the C40 offers, and I think it's that kind of force that could be a momentum for change on a whole range of issues. I think it's okay for mayors to say we're waiting for federal government or national government, but we can't wait any longer because there's an upward welling demand emerging from people for participatory democracy that operates differently. And so let us convene as cities and move together, because globalization has meant that the old sovereign borders have been softened in the process as well. And I think that we need new approaches, new ideas, new institutions to be able to drive the change.
Mayor Tao, what if you had, and you probably do in this audience today, if you had those institutions here, what would you say to them, to the World Bank, to the other global institutions about what they can do to, we often talk about mayors are, and part of our Climate Action and Megacities report is what the powers and the levers of power that mayors have. You're in charge of X, Y, and Z, so you can do the things that you want in those areas. But there are some times where the institutions that are supposed to help us are actually in the way. If you could tell us about either some specific examples of that or what you would say to those institutions to, I would be able to do these things if you guys could either just get out of the way or help me a little bit.
Or if you could, in fact, make life easier.
Right.
I mean, one of the things we did when we initiated the raising of our second bond, because the first bond that we raised was the first in a democratic dispensation for local government. We raised locally, and it was a relatively easy bond to raise. The second bond that we raised, because we needed to increase tenure and reduce price and get all the additional benefits, we approached them without getting into detail for a mechanism to underwrite a facility that we could raise. I can tell you that within a year, we wanted to undo the entire deal. Firstly, because the covenants in the structure were, the demands were excessive. The structure was a lot more complicated with multiple redemption periods and a redemption period that takes 3 years and a whole range of other covenants in the structure of the bond raising that made it difficult. So the point I'm really emphasizing is that both the mechanism to access the institutions but to also be able to implement within a framework that's reasonable is extremely difficult. I think that you need ease of access. You need a mechanism that ensures that you get competitive pricing for development initiatives, and you need a mechanism that finances and provides technical support, particularly in the developing world. Whilst we would have been prepared to take the risk and initiate such a product in the country, you find that it hasn't generated the interest. Every other municipality has stuck to the local markets because accessing international financing and international financing mechanism is near impossible. I mean, and the same applies to clean development mechanisms. In fact, we, as the city of Johannesburg, have had projects submitted for CDM funding, and the starting point is you need an established international consultant who's a specialist who understands the UN system, who understands the technical detail of how you submit for a transport project. That is a very expensive exercise on its own, long before you actually submit your project. As the market changed, we haven't even been able to tap into the market. We're using now our own resources to be able to proceed with the projects. And in many instances, I think that the appetite for accessing international financing in the developing world is very limited because of the structure and mechanisms created to access this.
You said it's sort of a shocking phrase, but I hear it almost to a person in terms of mayors that have to deal with trying to access international financing. You said nearly impossible. What do you do when you know when you run up against those hurdles and those walls? What do you do as a city, as the chief executive of a huge city like Johannesburg, when you can't access that international financing? I was talking to Mayor Macri of Buenos Aires about this a few months ago. He has a resiliency project, and he literally cannot unlock the World Bank funding for it, even though he says, I've done two of these, they've proven out, they've protected my city, I need to do this third one to make things happen. He can't unlock the funding. What do mayors do? Because, again, I keep referencing back to the climate action of megacities, but one of the most striking things about it is the innovativeness of mayors. They find ways around problems when they run into them, because you have to if you're a chief executive. I mean, what do you do in those instances? Mayor Robertson or Mayor Tao, please.
That's a really good question, because often we find ourselves at odds with the other levels of government, and that's an irreconcilable difference. In Canada, we have a government that's very focused on fossil fuel development, but most of our cities and communities are focused on becoming carbon neutral, and those goals, so we're completely at odds. Although the fossil fuel strategy is all about export, for the most part, we have a difficult time financing, getting matching funding. Even though Canada is a wealthy country, we have a very difficult time getting partners from the federal government or the provincial government to step up. Whether it's a big subway project that I'm trying to get in part of our city to fill a gap that will mean enormous reduction in pollution and traffic, we're not getting a willing partnership there, which holds us back. Basically, it focuses us to then look at, well, what can we do within our jurisdiction, within our financial means? What can we do? And example for us is focusing on district renewable energy. Doing at this point, we have five new projects coming forward to basically provide heat for neighborhoods throughout the city, and it's a multi-generational project that we can find private partners to come in with. We can work with the corporate sector, and we know we can provide renewable energy. And that's the elephant in the room for us in particular is we know we need to be carbon neutral. We need to eliminate our dependence on fossil fuels. And right now, there's no clear roadmap. There's no clear discussion, really, that's happening between cities, between countries, between industry, energy industry. How are we going to do this? We don't have that many years to accomplish it if we're paying attention to the science. Therefore, how do we go 100% renewable and create all kinds of economic opportunity that spans the job market, creates opportunity for the next generation to participate in distributed energy, renewable energy in every neighborhood, where the current system has locked out the younger generation from energy industry other than working on the rigs. So I think there's a win-win-win here, but having that conversation, having a mature conversation about going 100% renewable and starting with the cities, because we're on the front end of it, that would be a very welcome thing and something I think C40 is working in and around, but certainly something we needed more direct conversation with at all levels.
Are these, Mayor Tao, do you?
Yeah, I mean, just to emphasize the point that ultimately you do have to find solutions to work within the sovereign environment. Minister Manuel in his previous life was Minister of Finance, and we've had to go to the Minister of Finance and say, there are these initiatives that we're undertaking, these are the projects that we're undertaking, and this is our commitment. We need assistance and support from government. Of course, government would enable either through subsidies or through the development bank, a mechanism through which we can access funds. But there's also, I think, room for finding innovative solutions. I'm sure Mayor Pius would want to hear that we went to Pendes to raise funding for the first fleet of our BRT buses. So we accepted the reality that you can't gain access to financing upfront from the World Bank IFC, so we had to find alternative mechanism and we approached an export credit agency or went to the export credit agency market, and Pendes was the preferred bidder in this instance so that we can find cheaper financing with the ability to roll out the fleet. So you do have to continuously research, find innovative solutions to the problem, but we still have to make the case that accessibility needs to be created in a manner that's accessible to the countries and to the municipalities in those countries by these institutions so that it becomes easier and we can be able to leverage these resources, particularly because they are distributed disproportionately. And if you were to plot on a map the number of African cities that have accessed credit, that have accessed ECA funding or that have accessed carbon funding, it's a blob, really. It's very insignificant if you were to plot it against what the developed world has done. And that's an indicator of increased inequality as a result of inaccessibility to these institutions.
The innovativeness of mayors is, you know, is second to none, and it's one of the most exciting things about this organization. It's the reason you see 8,000 actions that mayors have taken since we started measuring them at C40, but it can't be the only answer. I mean, mayors, it sure as hell makes it a lot harder when mayors have to figure out a different solution around the systems and processes that are set up. Minister Manuel, do you see these, I mean, we were talking about how this is broken. Do you see these changing any time in the future to become more accommodating to mayors and sort of the new world order of mayors ruling the world?
Part of it requires a lot of innovation, because if you look at the World Bank, and let me just take forward the point that Mayor Tao makes, you know, if you submit a loan application, I don't think that the World Bank can resolve anything within a period that's shorter than 18 months. You can go to the capital markets, spend a week on a roadshow, and effectively bank the following week. And this is a big difference. And when we make the point that the multilaterals aren't keeping pace, it's very clear what's happening. You don't even want to talk about the cost of borrowing from these big institutions because of the overheads and so on. So part of what we need to do in this country, and we are involved in it, we've got a series of development finance institutions. We have a development bank focused on infrastructure supporting municipalities. We have an industrial development corporation focused very heavily on the green economy as well. These should support municipalities, some support from national government, but we must assist municipalities to reduce borrowing costs. The other issue, and let's just take forward this C20, C30, C40, the sooner we can identify the corporates, the easier it's going to be, because I think it's possible to construct the win-wins by creating local pools of capital, bring the corporates in. They need to step up to the plate in respect of changing their behavior as well. And I think that local authorities can actually play a much bigger role in persuading them. So getting money to do what municipalities must, I think, presents a number of challenges. And I think the big issue is turning to our mayors and saying, innovate, and we will support you in what you need to do.
I was going to ask, and you don't have to turn to you in 1 second, because I know that this conversation happens in Basel a lot, having been there. But of the three, and you don't have to say cities just because you're sitting here with a bunch of mayors, but of the three groups that you're targeting in the C20, C30, C40, who have you had the easiest or most difficult time in terms of getting to understand where you're trying to take the organization and take the world?
You know, at various points, it feels as though you're in the right space. I think on some of the issues, it was possible to persuade the G20 on issues. There are some places where you can persuade corporates in particular issues. But a forum like the C40, I think, is open. And there's a very strong relationship of trust that obtains here. And I think it's that's the investment that must actually create the momentum to drive the change in the other two. I don't think that it's always unwillingness. I think that frequently there's just the inability to see what the opportunities are that really present. And so, you know, it doesn't have to be from heads of state while mayors wait. You can, in fact, invert the process and effect change differently.
Mayor, tell us about some examples of where these conversations go in Basel, because I know there are a lot of frustrated mayors there sometimes. Minister Manuel talked about the capital markets and how they will have to be the ones that respond if the multilaterals don't, but tell us more about how those conversations go, and then I'd love to hear some examples of successes or failures where those have happened in Vancouver or Johannesburg.
Yes, you know, Switzerland is a rich country, so we have no need to have access to international fundings, but we can try to help people to have the access of international fundings, and so to bring them together. So to create trust, to create reliability, so to create also assets, so you can, the owners of the projects knows that their projects are sustainable infrastructure projects, and the fundings and the banks have their truth that it's okay. So that's the aim of this global infrastructure Basel, to bring them together, to have the discussions, to have the good solutions.
And I think we've had more success. You know, we've had some success with federal and provincial government partnering on big major projects, but we've had a lot of success on our more innovative job creating projects with private money, with philanthropy. We've had dollars come forward that are willing to take some risk, although we do a lot of work to mitigate risk and eliminate risk as a city, because there's a whole political side to it that is pretty unpalatable when things go sideways. We do an enormous amount of risk assessment with our projects. And even when the change that small dollars make, we were in Soweto the other day on the tour, and you see the difference that parks that are cleaning the water and providing exercise and green space for kids and seniors, the difference that the green schools, the BRT and the mobility that creates, these are enormous quality of life improvements that are creating jobs and that don't have much risk. You know, it's a lot of upside. And I would say all of our cities have probably hundreds and hundreds of projects like this. And when you accumulate all those, and part of it is if we have to do one by one by one by one, and you know, we get to the 800 actions, it would be really beneficial to be able to aggregate more and to be able to do massive infrastructure investments that improve quality of life, create jobs, but don't have a lot of risk associated with them. They're basically, you know, triple word scores, as we call them in Vancouver. And the measuring and reporting is an essential part of it. And Sadu Johnston, our superstar in Vancouver, is doing a next session about this. But then we're able to, with rigor, report out and say, here's the impact, here's the financial reality of it, here's the social improvement, the quality of life piece, and obviously the environment in many cases is a huge beneficiary. So if we can report out on all that, but it's how we get that willingness together when we know the results are going to happen on the ground in our cities.
So you show that some of the smaller projects work, and then you're able to build to bigger and bigger and bigger projects. I mean,
I think they accumulate, and the difference. The courage it takes Mayor Tau and in Johannesburg and the government of South Africa to invest on the ground is really remarkable, and you should be commended for that. And it's impressive to see it up close. And the difference that how quickly the change is happening here when those direct investments in community resilience are happening, and they will pay dividends, there's no question. And but just scaling all of that in cities all over the world, because the problems are accumulating as fast as the solutions at this point. Many cities are growing too fast, and the divide is growing. That's certainly one of our challenges. In Vancouver, we still have 20% of the population living in poverty, kids going hungry. People don't think of that, but a homelessness crisis is part of what brought me into office to deal with it. So we need to be proactive in all the cities, but those who have the most limited resources are being the most courageous right now, and we all need to do what we can to support.
Mayor Tau, I mean, transit-oriented development is not a small undertaking. It's a massive undertaking. It's a huge hugely capital intensive. How do you make that work? You're saying that it's nearly impossible to access international finance. How did you do that?
Well, we had to incorporate it into, in the first instance, the overall city planning framework, so that it's part of the spatial development framework of the city of Johannesburg. And then to identify strategic partners, with the government being the first set of partners that we had to engage to say, this is what we're initiating. This is how it interfaces with the National Development Plan, the commitments to spatial restructuring. This is what we're putting on the table from a financing point of view so that we can mobilize resources from there. But it's also about mobilizing the private sector. I mean, we've had discussions with the South African Property Owners Association so that we're able to present what the potential development opportunities would be, in as much as we've engaged with the key academic institutions in the city to say, how do we leverage the intellectual resources that they can bring to bear. So I think ultimately it's about building partnerships. It's about building almost a coalition of partners that are able to work towards a common objective. And it doesn't mean you're not going to confront problems. It doesn't mean that you're not going to find resistance. The natural NIMBY syndrome comes to play. But it's about presenting a vision that says the poor are an integral part of the city. We need to make the city accessible to the poor. We need to create equity in the city so that everybody can prosper from the city. Because our reality is that we're still dealing with the fact that as we're talking sustainability, sustainability is also about basic access to water, clean sanitation, electricity, a roof over your head. And that's part of the sustainable development agenda. It's about ensuring that those basic services are accessed by people, but they are also accessed in a way that makes them and the people of Johannesburg an integral part of what urban living is about. It's about closer proximity to amenities. It's about the benefits of the economies of agglomeration and economies of scale that cities create. And if you marginalized, you become socially excluded in your own city. And we're saying, for us to achieve a truly non-racial city that moves beyond apartheid, we need to be able to overcome the inefficiencies and the inequalities that are entrenched in space.
Thank you. We just have a few minutes left. I'd love to just go down the panel and get some parting thoughts from you. And if you can work this into your parting thoughts, it's second nature for all of you on the panel, the sharing that actually goes on between mayors. But I think a lot of people in the audience don't actually realize how this works. They're standing backstage, Mayor Pius is there. This group is all sharing ideas and say, well, that's a great idea. I'm going to call you later about that. But if you could work it in, you don't have to, but in sort of the parting thoughts here about how mayors actually work together and how you've solved problems by working with fellow mayors.
Yesterday we discussed on the governance of the cities and that we should have more influence on the national level, and I think that's a big topic, because in Switzerland we have a gap between the urban regions and the rural regions and the countryside. So our influence is not so big as we want to have this influence on the national level. So we have installed a trilateral conference twice a year with the national level, with the national government, the state level. I'm a governor also. I'm representing the state and the city. So I'm in between the national level and the city.
Do you yell at yourself sometimes if the state doesn't do what you mean?
I change the hats. I have two hats. So I'm
not that I've ever seen a mayor yell at a governor, I just mean.
So we have this trilateral meeting twice a day, this national level, state level, the regions and the cities, discussing such problems of infrastructures, financing also.
Well, I'd say two levels. I think there's our discussion yesterday talking about the global predicament, and the minister has spoken some of that, how broken it is. It's hard to imagine we're going to move that this year or next year. But I think under Mayor Pace's leadership, we do have an opportunity. I think there's a lot of consensus among mayors. We need to be more assertive, keep making our case, and forwarding the work of our cities, demonstrating over and over that we're willing partners, and we want to work the corporate and government. We want more responsibility to be able to solve our challenges. At the same time, I'd say in this forum, we have enormous opportunity gathered. I mean, the brain power in this room, the mayors, we're just out front and saying nice things and trying to keep everybody happy, but a lot of the real work is done by the experts in this room, the enormous firepower here. And I'd say the more we get, when we are together, we get to working sessions, workshopping, and actually, you know, crunching through what are the hardest pieces, the biggest challenges, and where cities can group together and solve. I think we could be more nimble when we are gathered like that. I mean, I like the talk show thing up here. It's good too. But I think we've got so much talent and passion in the room that we can probably get more out of that when we're more focused in working sessions. And certainly when the mayors are together, we can move mountains at times. And it's great to have the opportunity.
Thank you. Mayor Tao.
Well, I think that C40, amongst others, is one of those organizations that add value to the work that we're able to do in our cities. Also from the point of view that it is an organization that has said that it is not just about association, it's about action. So we need to be able to measure what we're doing. We need to be able to say, this is my contribution. And the discussion amongst ourselves is, but what happens with those that are not doing anything with regards to climate change? Do you remain a member simply by association, or is it membership on the basis of your commitment? And I found that amongst the organizations that we participate in, the ability to hold each other accountable against a set of objectives and to say we are going to measure what's happening, what you're doing, and the different actions being undertaken is important to help us move forward. I do think that the opportunity that Minister Manuel presents is possibly something that we all need to take advantage of, because I think that it is an opportunity to say we can work collectively between local government, private enterprise, and national governments. And because we're not inhibited by the limitations of the negotiations in the UN system, we can, through practical action, scale up the initiatives being undertaken on a collective partnership that says, let's set ourselves targets and let's demonstrate that it actually can work.
And Minister Manuel, I know sometimes at C40 we're a little tough on state and national governments, but both from the conversation backstage and on stage, I think all of us, and certainly the mayors in the room, could say that we wish there were more legislators like you in our countries, because I think a lot more would end up happening.
You know, in my day job, Jake, I chair the National Planning Commission, it's in government. I'm a member of cabinet, but the commissioners are drawn from outside of government. And we've developed a national development plan, which is pretty high level. It needs a lot of detail. And I think it affords us an opportunity to construct a series of social compacts to deliver. And I think that that would be our key performance indicator at the end of it. There's a story today because fixing education in this country, as we must, involves NGOs, education departments, private sector. There's an all-in effort. They had a press conference on this yesterday. There's an all-in effort driving the change. And I think in a similar way across a broad pan of responsibilities that impact on the daily lives of people, we've got to construct these kinds of compacts. And through that way, I think we will learn to trust each other differently. And that's what's important for us. And, you know, I know the National Development Plan went out some time ago, but I think that there's a new basis, new reality, and a new opportunity for reconstructing relationships, not just within government, but between the three spheres of government we have in this country and others outside of them, so that we can drive programs together. There must be some issues that actually come off the table, even at election time, and ensure that we have our ongoing commitment to our people. And that, I think, is a very important message that I'd like to leave with the mayors here. Thanks.
Thank you. And on that note, thank you very much, mayors and minister.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next breakout session will begin in approximately 10 minutes at 10:05. The next plenary session will begin at 11:30. Please return your translation headsets as you exit the plenary. Thank you.